Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Yeah, my biggest issue with Cabrera being walked intentionally in the eighth inning, the game was in Detroit. If the game were in the Bronx, I don't think I'd say much of anything. That's my biggest issue. The game's in Detroit. Those people paid to see him. Pitch to him.
I actually don't have a problem with it, believe it or not, but we can get to that later.
I understand the strategy of the game. I got it. It paid off. They got a double play out of it. But guess what? Paying customers are paying customers. The game's in Detroit. But what are you walking him intentionally for? Just pitch to him.
Well, no, they got the double play before Cabrera came up. So they got the. It was a 1-0 game. They got the double play. Then Cabrera comes up. He's intentionally walked. There's still a guy at third with two out. And then he's intentionally walked. So that you have runners in the corners with two out. Then Austin Meadows doubles and makes it 3-0. And then that was. And then they had the final out after that. That was the whole sequence.
Guess what? Okay? They did not come there to pay to watch you manage. They paid to watch him hit. They came here to watch him make history. Okay? You made no history today. You made a fool out of yourself. I mean, seriously. They paid to watch him make history. And you looked at them and you gave them the middle finger. Really? That's how you get people to want to come back? That's how you grow the popularity of the game?
If it wasn't a one-run game, I would be right with you.
No, these people paid to see him hit. They came here to see him with the possibility of history, and you're intentionally walking him? Really? Really? You take the bat out of his hands, and you look at everybody and go, you know what? I'm more important than you are. You are more important than they are. Okay? Guess what? Have some confidence in your pitcher. You can get him out. Sorry. He's sitting there at home on the cusp of a slice of history, and you walk him intentionally? Really? Really? Wow. Sorry. But after a while, you sit back and go, you know what? Life is not a mathematical equation of probability. It's just not. I just think you wonder why you've already had a manager in conjunction with his player make a decision. It's a perfect game. All these people have endured all this cold, but he's coming out of the game. Everybody's looking at each other like, okay, I guess I'll go home now. Same thing with this. Hey, this is good. What? They're walking him intentionally? I didn't pay to see this. Sorry. There's a right way and a wrong way to go about it. They went about it the wrong way today. And again, it's just another day for Major League Baseball where for whatever reason, Major League Baseball has the tendency to always do the wrong thing. Why? And today, Aaron Boone did the wrong thing. Sorry. Okay? See these people out here? These are called customers. Okay? They help pay your freight. Give them what they came to pay for. Let them hit. If it's somebody else, I got it. But not this guy. They came here to see him hit. They paid their money to see him hit. In their ballpark, and you're like, no, it's 1-0. I gotta, you know, guess what? You lost 3-0 instead of 1-0. Ooh, great strategy. I'm thrilled for you. Come on. I find it indefensible. Okay? This is a fan. Sports are fan based. You got to give them what they're paying for. They did not come there to watch you manage. Nobody came there to watch you manage. Just like I always tell everybody all the time, nobody came there to watch you umpire or referee. Okay? Pitch to him. He's got 2,999 hits at home. Pitch to him. You walk him intentionally? You take the bat out of his hand? What? Right? I mean, you literally hold up four fingers. He doesn't even see a pitch. And you think that's good? I mean, that's good? That's good for the game. I don't think it's good for the game. I think that stinks. The heck? Aaron Boone cares about Aaron Boone. All right. Let's do our play-by-play call of the day. I think I have a pretty good feeling what it's going to be.
And Nick Nurse is telling Van Vliet to get back into the lane, play defense there, because, again, just 0.9 on the shots. Embiid turns, fires for the win. Joel Embiid! And the Sixers take game three here in Toronto.
And the crowd is silent. Everybody, mouth shut. Not a peep out of anybody in this building right now.
They're saying there's still 0.7 on the clock.
As we take a look at the action again. Listen, I wouldn't recommend this,
going away from
but it counts, and it silences everybody in the building.
Kate Scott, El Abdanabi with the call on the Sixers TV network. There was 2.6 seconds to go. There was 0.9 on the shot clock, and they had the ball at midcourt after it got knocked out of bounds. And threw it in, and Embiid turned and just knocked down the three. It was a great shot, great moment. And the Sixers are up 3-0 in the series. If I'm the Sixers, the one thing that worries me is James Harden is not playing well. Now, obviously, Maxey's playing terrific. Embiid's playing very well. Harden is not. And remember, Toronto doesn't have – look, they don't have Kawhi Leonard anymore. They don't have Kyle Lowry. They don't have – a mix of go-to players. So the Sixers should be up 3-0 in the series. He's got better players. All right. Let's get to Mark Brennan, 247 Sports. Mark, always a pleasure. Great to have you with us.
Yeah, it's great to be here, Steve. Thanks for having me.
Not many stories, I think, shock you these days, but I was really taken aback when I saw Jay Wright was retiring. What did you think when you heard it?
Yeah, as a longtime Philadelphia 76ers fan, every time that job opened, I was kind of hoping that Jay Wright would take it. But I guess he's saying he's out of coaching for good. So, listen, it seems to me I don't know Jay. I know of the program, obviously. I'm a guy who's been a big Philadelphia fan and have always followed Villanova. But it seems to me like he's accomplished what he thought he wants to accomplish, and you can't argue with that. He's a Hall of Famer. I was stunned to hear that he's only 60 years old. I mean, that's kind of, putting things into some perspective. But, credit to him for walking away when he's happy to walk away.
It's interesting that Roy Williams walked away. Now, I know Mike Krzyzewski's 75, and now Jay Wright's walking away. Should we read into anything with the way the current climate is in college sports with this happening with veteran coaches, or is that too much of a leap?
I think it might be a little bit too much of a leap. I mean, I know where you're coming from with the transfer portal and all the NIL stuff. It's really become just a completely different thing. But I think with all of those coaches, Steve, they were so well established and had accomplished so much. That to me, I could understand them just walking away because they felt it was the time to walk away. Obviously, with Coach K, I think it's very difficult. With all due respect to anybody who's coached into their later years, I just think anymore it's very difficult to do that. And just with everything those guys accomplished, I think they just have so much they could hang their hats on. But yeah, I mean, I would say maybe a little bit. But to me, I think where you might see a difference, and I don't know how we'd ever quantify this, is less people willing to get in it and stay in it for a long, long time. Less people getting out after 10 years. or people getting out after 12 years, you know, that sort of thing, because it just grinds them down.
All right. And quickly on the Penn State basketball front, two transfers are definitely in, Andrew Funk from Bucknell, Cameron Winter from Drexel.
Yeah.
What were your thoughts on the two of them coming in? Because obviously with another one available, they'd like to get a big man in.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, Cameron is a guy who terrific point guard, very well rounded. I mean, the one thing he did not do well last year, I think you know this, is shoot the three.
Yeah.
But that's where I think bringing in a guy like Funk, you know, they kind of complement one another. I don't know how much they'll actually be on the court together with all the other pieces that Penn State has. But, yeah, I mean, I think you're bringing in two guys who are going to complement the players who are there. But I do think it's imperative for them to get another big guy. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at who they lost, the amount of minutes, the amount of production that John Harrod gave you.
Yeah.
To rely on two true freshmen to come in and kind of handle that load, I think, would be very difficult to do. So two nice additions. I also like the fact that they were able to, you know, look around the state, see two guys who were very good at the mid-major level in state, and give these guys an opportunity. Obviously, you know, these kids aren't from Pennsylvania per se, but to give both of these guys an opportunity, you know, it's just kind of going back to what we were talking about earlier. It's a whole new ball game for these coaching staffs. No longer do you just have to scout high school players. You really have to be scouting throughout the year other college players, you know, just wondering who's going to come open. And when they do, you know, make a move early and get them in here. But clearly in these first few years, it's probably going to be this way forever. But I think in the first couple years of the Micah Shrewsbury tenure, the transfer portal has been big, and I think will continue to be big.
All right, so let's transition now to football. As you sit down and go through the checklist of what you're looking for on Saturday, what would be some of the things and items that would be on that checklist?
I think number one is the offensive line. I mean, I know that they've been banged up, you know, not everybody who will be playing will be playing next season, will be there playing this Saturday, you know, including a guy like Hunter Norzad, the guy, the transfer who's coming in. But the line to me last year, I went into last season thinking that had the opportunity to be a strength, and frankly, it wasn't. And, you know, I think, we're in year two or three under Phil Troutwine. I think we want to start seeing these guys showing some cohesion and kind of coming together. So that's one area. I think, obviously, you know, everybody's talking about the backup quarterbacks. I'll be surprised if we see a whole heck of a lot of Sean Clifford just because we don't have to. So, you know, what do we see? What do we see from Aveyu? What do we see from Alar and from Bo Pribule, if I can spit it out?
That's okay. That's my job.
Yeah. And yeah, exactly. You actually do it on the fly, which I don't know how the heck you do it. And listen, everybody's hearing really, really good things. And I know I can't put you in a spot, but all we're hearing is great things about Nick Singleton. So I'm anxious to get a look at him and see what they actually allow him to do, or whether they want to try to keep that under wraps. And over on defense, just how everybody's kind of adjusting to Manny Diaz. I mean, you know, it seems to me when we talk to the players and to the other coaches, the one thing that has, I don't want to say jumped out, but the one thing that I think has been a common thread has been his abilities as a communicator.
Yeah.
And, you know, to step into a situation like this where Brent Pry did a tremendous job, was beloved by his players. Mm-hmm. That's not always an easy thing to do. But to be able to step in, be your own personality, not try to be Brent Pry, and install your stuff, you know, to me, from all indications, the communication has been there. And then I think everybody, listen, if people haven't heard about this kid, keep an eye on Zane Durant. He appears to be an undersized defensive tackle, but he is 285 pounds or whatever it is of pure muscle, early enrollee D tackle. He's going to be a guy who plays a lot of football. Now, I'm not saying he's going to start, but everybody is talking this kid up. And Steve, you've been in this long enough to know that one of the most difficult spots to make an immediate impact at the college level, you know, one is obviously offensive line and one is defensive line. For an early enrollee who should still be in high school now to come in and be the talk of spring camp, I think that's impressive. And, you know, I'm hoping they let him loose a little bit. I'm anxious to see what he does. And that'll be fun to see how that defensive line in general, you know, Adisa Isaac coming back, Hakeem Beeman, that kind of goes in line with what I said about the offensive group. You know, I think you have a lot of talent there. Let's see how these two groups kind of go at one another.
A lot of people obviously are incredibly curious, and justifiably so, about Drew Aller and Bo Prabula. Christian Veau went through spring practice last year, and it was the first time he'd done any football work of any kind because his fall season in 2020 was canceled. What are you looking for out of him now that he has a year under his belt?
Well, yeah, and I think the other thing, Steve, was the opportunity that he got in the Rutgers game. I mean, that is just absolutely invaluable. Mm-hmm. So not only did he go in, but he went in and he was a productive player, and they didn't really dumb everything down for him. I mean, you know, I don't think it was the entire thing that Clifford would have run. But yeah, I mean, so now all of a sudden, I think you look back to where they were last year, and this is with all due respect to where Veau was at that point, but you, as you said, he didn't play his senior year. And Taquan Roberson, I mean, they had one proven quarterback at the D1 level in the program. Now, I think you can say you have two, and I think you have two guys who project as that. So all of a sudden, you have four legit D1 QBs, and that's a much different position than where they were. And I think we all know, you know, we could look back, and again, Taquan Roberson, tremendous kid. I think he was just in over his head, and we saw that out at the Iowa game. Mm-hmm. How might that whole season be a little bit different if they had a more prepared backup at that point? And I think it would have been a lot different.
What is your post-game approach as to how you write about blue-white games, considering it is a spring scrimmage and they won't be back in camp until the beginning of August? What is the approach you like to take from a writer's point of view?
I don't want to give away my secrets. No, I've said this before, but what I'll do, Steve, seriously, what I'll try to do is we're going to have media room access with players for the first time since pre-pandemic, okay? So that's number one.
Yep.
So that is in and of itself is going to be interesting, and I really welcome that back. But I'm going to look around, and I'm going to see where the biggest crowd of people is, and I'm going to go in the opposite direction.
Right.
And I'm going to look for guys who maybe we haven't had as much chance to talk to. You know, maybe a Malik Mega, you know, maybe some of these younger guys. Now, they don't allow the true freshmen to talk, the early enrollees. I'm not sure if they'll allow any of the true freshmen from last year to talk. Which is fine. I never have any issue with that. I know people have always complained, even back under Joe, and it's like, you know what? We will have plenty of time to talk to these guys throughout right. their careers. Right. There's no reason to rush it. I know when I was in college, obviously, I didn't play sports at anything close to this level, but I would have been terrified as a freshman to have to face goofballs like me. But I think that's one of the real keys. And I try to do the same thing at Media Day, where you see where the crowd is. Everybody's going to have that, right? So I think it's more important to go and talk to some of the people you've never really had a chance to talk to. I always remember, I forget which year it was, you know, you're better with these years than I was, but we're at football media day and nobody was around Darryl Clark, like nobody.
Right.
I think he had just come into the program. You know, there was some academic issues or something.
Right.
He'd
gone to Kiski, I think.
Yeah. So it was, he had committed 1 year and then he had to go to Kiski. And the thing about Darryl Clark, this isn't a knock on him because anybody who's ever talked to him, he's a super intelligent guy.
No doubt.
So I'm not sure what happened during his high school career. But the point being, I think that was back when it was Morelli and who else was going at it. I mean, there were people competing for the job. Morelli was the well-known quarterback, and there's Darrell Clark sitting by himself. And you know this, Steve, because you've talked to Darrell Clark a lot. But I went over, and I talked to Darrell Clark one-on-one, and wow, I'm just like, this kid is something else. And, of course, as he goes through his career, everybody gets how intelligent he is. Everybody gets his personality. But I was fortunate enough to see that relatively early. I was able to do that with C.J. Thorpe as well, even though C.J. is a guy who moved on from Penn State. But you get to know some of these younger players. And, you know, I know that you talked to Tyler Donahue earlier. A lot of our recruiting people get to know them even earlier than that. Mm-hmm. But to get to know some of these young guys, I think, is always kind of a fun thing to do, to talk to them for the first time.
One final question that deals with rules. The NCAA came out with rule changes. And, you know, for the most part, they're pretty, you know, they're subtle and they're fine. But one was, if you get a targeting call in the second half of a game, you can then appeal it and the NCAA will review it. And if they see it your way, the player can play in the first half of the next game. If they don't, you see still out of the first half of the next game. What did you think of that?
Yeah, I like it. I mean, I think anything where that you can use video to get something right. Listen, I think we all know that being an official is a very difficult job, and to try to make those bang-bang decisions on those little micro TVs and stuff, even if you have help from up in the booth, you know, to me, if you have time to take a step back and get it right, I think that's a good thing. I have no issue with that whatsoever, so long as they do it the right way. And, again, I think that putting in that rule, the spirit of it is in the right place. So, I like that. You know, I like the fact that they didn't make these poor players take that walk of shame after they, penalized.
Right.
And, make them leave. And, that to me, I don't know who was even thinking about that. I didn't see all the rule changes, but I was really hoping that they would adjust that overtime rule, Steve, because
they didn't.
After suffering through that one, I know that was just, that has to be the dumbest way of overtime, the dumbest approach to overtime that I've ever thought of. So I was really hoping they would change that, and I'm sorry they didn't.
I felt like I was doing World Cup penalty kicks. All right.
Well, I was down shooting video on the field. So imagine me. I'm old and decrepit and tired, and I'm running from one end of the field to the other.
Man.
It was hilarious.
Oh my goodness, Mark! Always a pleasure. I'm really looking forward to seeing you on Saturday.
Yeah, it should be a fun time. It should be. I think it's going to be good weather eventually, and I'm glad that the blue white game is back. Listen, Steve, first time since 2019. This is such a big part of not only Penn State, but James Franklin said it yesterday, of this entire State College community. You and I are now State College guys, and to have this back, to do what it does for in a positive way for all these local businesses, I just think it's such a great thing. So I'm happy that it's back and look forward to seeing you and everybody else Saturday.
That's great. Well said, Mark. Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
Sure. Thank you, Steve.
Mark Brennan, 247 Sports. Aaron Boone just ordered to have the entire Tigers lineup intentionally walked.
It was a one-run game. If it was a blowout, then I would have a problem with it. He's trying to win the game.
No, I got a big problem with it. Those people did not pay to watch him intentionally walk. Sorry. It's not how... You know what? You got to have a sense and feel for what's actually going on and what people care about. It is, to be honest with you, it's actually indefensible. The fans mean nothing to these people, and they wonder why 2,000 are showing up in Oakland. Literally 2,000.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Did you see last week what Joe Madden did?
I did not.
He had an intentional walk with the bases loaded. Hey, really?
Wait, there the bases were loaded, and he did it intentionally, and he intentionally walked somebody.
Yeah. Supposedly, it's the third time ever it's happened.
All right, now that is dumb. That is letting analytics just fully take you over. Yeah, that one is extremely dumb.
I think he said something like he was trying to fire his team up or something like that. When you're going, okay.
What?
I have no
idea.
Yeah,
they'll be fired up at you.
I have no idea. All right. Then you got all these people on a cold day in Detroit, and like, I'm going to walk him intentionally. Like, no, I paid to watch him hit and get a 3,000. No, really? Yeah.
But unlike Joe Madden, Aaron Boone's trying to win a ball game.
You can win a game by getting. He struck out twice in the game. You don't have to walk.
I know, but
no, that's that... not. People pay to see people play. They do not pay to watch Aaron Boone. Okay, manage. Okay. How many World Series has he managed in? Oh, that's right, zero. Okay, good. He's done quite a job. I'm just sorry. I mean, I'm sick of the fan being ripped off all the time because somebody just thinks they're going to be smarter than everybody else. I mean, sorry. These people paid money. Let him hit. He is 0-for-3 in the game. You can get him out, right?
Chances are you could, but you still never know. And when you're down a run, you got to do what you got to do. I'm sorry.
So how many runs did they give up after they walked him intentionally? Two. Yeah. Worked out great. Perfect. Nice job. Boom. Great strategy. Beautiful. Nice job. What a manager. Wow. Really impressed. All these people did not show up today to watch this. You've got to have a sense of what the heck's going on around you. I'm not saying you give him a hit. You're absolutely not trying to give him a hit. But you hold up four fingers, you're telling everybody, yeah, now forget this. You guys can go home now. I mean, really? That's Major League Baseball in April? I'm trying to win a game? Guess what? It was 1-0. What was the final?
It was 3-0.
What was? Yeah, that's right. So it didn't work. Did it.
But think of it this way, too. If he did get the hit, what would Yankee fans be saying?
They wouldn't even thought about walking him intentionally. It was the bases weren't going to be loaded.
There would have been runners on the corners with two outs. You had already had a guy at third with two outs after they just got the double play. It's a 1-0 game. You got Miggy Cabrera up. Yeah, he's 0-for-3, okay, but you know what? He hurt you the night before. You got to do what you got to do.
You got two outs, and you're walking him intentionally when you need an out? You can't defend this. It's absurd. It's absurd. Okay? People pay money. You have a chance to see a slice of history, and you got a guy over there going, four fingers, we're done. Everybody go home. I don't care how much money you paid. You're not going to watch him hit because I'm more important than all of you. Really. There's two outs, right? You need an out, and you walked him intentionally? What the heck sense does that make? Right? There's two outs when he walked him, right?
Correct, yeah. There was a guy on third with two out.
And you walked him intentionally?
I mean, it's one thing not to have confidence in the pitcher to get him out. All right, I get that. It's a separate argument, but I get that. But if I'm trying to win the game and I think my guy has a better shot to strike out or get an out against whoever was in back of Miggy Cabrera, I'm going to do it.
He's 0-for-3 with two strikeouts. Why aren't you pitching to him? He had three hits last night. He has no hits today.
And also, that's a perfect spot for him to get that hit, to get a hit, and then you give up a run.
Anybody can be in that spot and get that hit. What are you going to walk them all? What are you going to do? For goodness sakes, this is not Miguel Cabrera in his prime, you know. This is not 10 years ago when he's winning the Triple Crown. He's 90.
I haven't defended Aaron Boone much this year, but this one I'm okay with.
He puts out first and third with two outs with the walk. It's bizarro world. It's a bizarro world. Makes no sense. Right? All these people paid money to watch him hit. Okay, there's two outs. Where's the risk here? Let him hit. It was 1-0, right? What was the final again?
It was 3-0.
Oh, so it didn't work?
It did not.
Didn't work for anybody. Didn't work for the fans. It didn't work for the Yankees. Didn't work for anybody. I mean, that's... I'm telling you, they had a really good crowd at Detroit today. A really good crowd. And you just sit back and... I'm sorry, it's... There's something really wrong with the game when you do something like that.
But that's not on Aaron Boone. That's on the powers that be who have been dumb as a doornail that put the game in this spot.
There is a runner on third, okay? It's not like second and third, and we're going to put a runner on and get a force at any base. There's a runner on third where Miguel Cabrera hits a fly ball, and guess what? It'll end the inning. It's not even a sacrifice fly. It makes even strategically very little sense, let alone moment. See, there's too much about this that makes no sense. It's not as if there's nobody out, all right, and guess what? I'm going to walk the bases loaded. We're going to get a force out at every base, whatever. There's a runner on third. There's two outs. I don't care who's up, I'm pitching to him. I don't care if Aaron Judge is up, I'm not walking him. There's a runner on third with two outs. Why would I walk Aaron Judge? Why? Or why would I walk Giancarlo Stanton? Why? I need an out. 7 times out of 10, he makes an out. So you want to do math? See that's part bothers me, right? It's something about it that just flat out just strategically lacks logic, and it just plain stinks for the game. It's another case of, you know, I'm the smartest guy in the building, and you got thousands of fans there. A lot of them came out today, and they probably had a higher attendance because they wanted to watch him hit. And situationally, it makes no sense. Tell me what sense it makes. Situationally, does it make any sense situationally? If there's second and third, okay, you want to force, you walk. Okay, I got it. Okay. But tell me situationally where this makes sense. I don't know. And you think it's great.
It's not ideal, but he's trying to make sure that a guy that hurt him last night, I get he's 0-for-3 in the game, but he's trying to win the game. I can't blame him for trying to win the game. But like I said, if it's already 3-0 at that point, even if it's already 2-0 at that point, then you should let him hit. because I don't. If you were to give up a run in that spot, it's not going to make that big a difference, because then the game probably would be over at that point. But it still wasn't. It was still a one-run game, and it had been that way for a few innings, because I think they got the first run in the fifth inning. We also just had a caller, someone just called in who was listening, and he said that not only they still would give the Yankees would have a force out at second, too.
I already said that. Who cares? You need one out. Who cares? In other words, I should start off every inning, but I might as well walk him. Now I got a force out at second. We can get a double play. You need an out. You just got a double play. You just got a double play. There's two outs. I'm sorry. It's indefensible. There's no way in the planet you could defend. Oh, it's brilliant. It's whatever. No, it's stupid. Okay? Thousands of people showed up to watch that guy hit. You need an out. You've got him out all day, including two strikeouts. Right? What's wrong with him taking a shot here? I mean, it was obviously okay to pitch to Austin Meadows. Well, you know, why not walk Austin Meadows? Why didn't you walk Austin Meadows? Any reason?
Because obviously Aaron Boone thought that was a better matchup to have him face Meadows than face Miggy Cabrera, who, again, wasn't great in this particular game, but is capable and had hurt them this entire series.
What, Meadows didn't?
Actually, I don't think he has, to be honest with you. I have to go back and double check, but
he hurts you now. He doubled in two runs.
But I would rather you try to win in that way than just give in because the fans want to see somebody get a milestone.
You need one out. Hey, you don't need two outs. You don't need to have a double play ball. You already got your double play ball. You don't need a double play. You just need an out against a guy that can't run. Come on. This isn't trying to, like, you're not trying to stop Ichiro here, who puts the ball on the ground and might beat it out. Come on. That's what across the board, it makes no sense. It makes no sense. Then he got what he deserved. He got a double by Meadows. Classic backfire. I mean, I'm sorry, it's not defensible. People pay good money to watch people play. They don't pay good money to watch Aaron Boone manage. And by the way, in terms of managing the game, to be honest with you, strategically, he blew it there. He gave up two runs. Right? Did Meadows double in two runs?
He did.
As the next hitter? As the next hitter. They walked Cabrera to pitch to Meadows.
Correct.
And what did Meadows do?
He doubled, but it's like trying to foul somebody who is a bad free throw shooter. You'd rather try to have them make the free throws to ice the game rather than to give to somebody who's like a 90% free throw shooter. That's what he's trying to do here. He would rather have had Austin Meadows, who isn't at the prominent player like Miguel Cabrera is, beat them than have Miguel Cabrera beat them in a one-run game. But again, like I said, if it's a two-run game or if it's a multiple-run game and he did that, then I'd be right there with you.
Hey,
but because it's
Jason,
a one-run game, it's different. You have to try to win the ball game.
With two outs.
Doesn't matter. You still have that guy up there. Either way, you're going to give up a run. So if I'm going to try to give up a run, I'm going to try and get the guy out who I think I can get out. Either way, you have to get an out. So let's think of who I can get out better. I can get Austin Meadows out better, or I can get Miggy Cabrera out better, who's killed me the whole series. I'm going to get out, try and get out Austin Meadows, and if he beats me, then so be it. And I bet you every Yankee fan would have ripped Aaron Boone had he kept Miggy Cabrera in there, and he would have brought in that run to make it a 2-0 game. I bet you every Yankee fan in New York media would have ripped him for that. I guarantee you.
Another step in the wrong direction for the game of baseball today. And the fact that you're defending it is really kind of sad. It's sad.
I can't help where the game is right now. That's Rob Manfred's fault. But Aaron Boone can't be thinking, oh, gee, the game's in bad shape because I have a stupid commissioner. Well, sorry. Guess what? I got
to
try to win the ball game.
To be honest with you, you're dead wrong on this. It's not even close to being right or wrong. You're dead wrong. There's two outs. You need an out. The guy's 0 for 3. Oh, by the way, has a chance at home to make some history. What the heck? That's what people pay for? Look, we'll challenge him. Let's see what happens here. All right? I need one out. I need an out. I mean, okay, even situationally, it makes no sense. And I don't want to hear, oh, these are forced at second. Oh, great. Well, guess what? There's one out. Maybe I'll walk him intentionally. Now I got a chance at a double play. Nobody does that. Nobody. Okay? I'll do in the fourth inning. Hey, guess what? There's one out. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to walk him intentionally. That way we have a force at second. What are you doing? I don't need to do that. In fact, there's two outs. I'm going to walk him intentionally. Now we got a force at second. No, you're going to get him out. Come on. And yet, even a fly ball to center field is an out. There's no run. You want to know why there's no run? Because there's two outs, so you can't get a sacrifice fly. You also have a guy in Austin Meadows who can run versus a guy in Cabrera who can't. So it doesn't make sense on a lot of different levels, let alone the history level. You just sit back and go, what are you doing here? Makes no sense. What makes sense? What part of Austin Meadows can run and Miguel Cabrera can't? Where does that make sense? Where does that make sense with two outs? Okay? He can run, he can't. So his odds of actually beating out a hit would be greater than Miguel Cabrera's. I mean, Cabrera has to actually hit the ball to a spot to get a base hit. He can't beat out an infield hit. Even if the ball's juggled, there's a good chance you're going to get Miguel Cabrera out, only because at his age right now and the size of the man, he can't run anymore. Where does this make sense? It makes no sense. None. Zero. Sorry, you're not right about this. Oh, it's great strategy. It's not great strategy. It's a Bengal. What are you doing?
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle's worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.